Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Ethics and Morality. It is part of the Human Soul series. It was presented in Melbourne, Australia, on the 13th of May 2012. This is Session 1, Part 1.
So how's everyone this morning, bright and early? The bright and early is not so good sometimes, is it? Particularly on a Sunday morning, it's like, is it raining? It's ideal sleeping weather, isn't it? Yeah. So, the subject I wanted to speak with you about today, I feel is a very important subject for your own and other people's welfare, actually. And I'm still uncertain about what to call it. So I've just got to have a think for a second about how I'm going to call what I'm going to call this presentation. Let's call it part of a series that I'd like to do called Love in Action, and. And I want to call it ethics, I think. Have you ever done much philosophizing about ethics? Yeah. In the first century, this was a something of primary concern to me, because quite frequently you would see in society, just as you do today, a lack of ethics, a lack of morality, what I'd call morality. So let's call it ethics. And morality, shall we? I'm not sure we'll get to morality section so let's call this part one or session one, because I feel that today we probably only get the chance to speak primarily about ethics and the principles of love involved in ethics. Okay. In the first century, I spoke quite frequently to groups of people about one principle, because I was quite often, as I am today, asked the question of, how do I know what's loving? Most people say to me, like, you know, I realise now that I'm not very developed in love, or I realise now that, you know, I'd really got no idea what love is, and I realise now that it's a difficult for me to understand how to treat other people lovingly and so forth. Does that make sense? If we could have the mobile, whoever that is, turned off, that'd be great. It's so embarrassing, isn't it, when they go off and you think, oh, I forgot about that. And so what I would say to them is I'd answer them with one primary principle, which in the Bible has now come to be called the Golden Rule. Do any of you know it? The Golden Rule? If we need to mic though. So what's the Golden Rule?
As I understand it, it's just treat others as you would have them treat you.
Yes, so let's just write that. That's a very short summary of what I used to say, but that's that's okay. So how does it spell? Treat others as you treat you. Well, it's more than just loving thy neighbour, actually. This statement has a lot involved in it, if you think about it, to the degree of which I would like you to have a think about it, actually. You could say that you could rephrase it in a way, couldn't you? And you could say, would I like to be treated in the manner I treat others. You see, quite often people say to me, look, I don't really know what love is. And in a way, it's almost used as an excuse to act in an unloving manner. Say, I don't know how to treat people lovingly, and it's sort of a way of sort of disassembling or disconnecting from how we treat other people. So it's a way of getting away with poor behaviour. If you always ask this single question, would I like to be treated in the manner in which I treat others? You would very frequently be able to determine unloving behaviour. Can you see why? Because quite often we complain severely about how other people treat us, or how we observe other people treating other people, when quite often we ourselves are involved in exactly the same behaviour towards other people without noticing it at all. And the reason why is because generally we have a couple of emotional difficulties and problems. One problem that we have is that we're generally hypocrites. In the sense that we want other people to treat us in a way that we are not prepared to treat them. And to demand something of another person or ask something of another person that we are not prepared to do ourselves is a very hypocritical state. We're just being hypocritical in that place. We are therefore being unloving, because when I demand of you something that I'm not prepared to give to you, then I am being unloving to you, and I am no longer in a state of ethical integrity. Can you see that? If I am prepared to give to you what I'm asking of you, now at least, even if that's wrong, even if what I'm asking you is wrong, if I'm prepared to give you exactly what I'm asking for you from you, at least I am in a state of ethical integrity. Can you see the difference? Whereas if I am not able to give to you what I am asking of you, then I am in no state of ethical integrity. And this is why I wanted to discuss the principle of ethics with you. So it's not, this is a facet, you could call it a facet of love that we need to learn. Mary, you'd like to just wait for the mic to warm up there?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay.
Thanks, Fab. This discussion is very topical for me, mm-hmm. and I feel like I want to engage this with my soul. So the first thing that comes up for me is about my family, mm-hmm. and the way I grew up. There was a lot of bargains, I suppose, or bartering in my family. Mm-hmm. So if one person felt something, we should all feel with them.
Yes.
And that's I wanted that as well. So say we're a family, if you felt something, we'd feel that with you, and then when I felt something, I'd expect you guys to feel that with mm-hmm. me. Mm-hmm. Now...
And that is ethical.
Yeah, this is my question. You're saying that's ethical. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it... Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So if I wanted you to share in my emotions and then at the same time did not want you to share... I did not want to share in yours, now I would be unethical.
Yeah.
Right? But what I'm pointing out is that there are layers of love, and the first layer of love is this. So the second layer of love is being able to treat other people in a manner that they do not treat you, but that you would like them to treat you. So that's the second layer, if you like. But we can't even get to that layer if we're already unethical. If we're already unethical in our treatment of other people, we are never going to grow in love to a deeper level than that. Yeah. And so while I'm not saying that ethics is a proof of love, right, what I am saying is that ethics is a part of the process of becoming more loving.
And it's an aspect of our self-reflective process, isn't it?
Very much so.
If we don't self-reflect, we're hardly ethical, are we?
Yeah. In fact, if you're incapable of self-reflection, then you're going to be incapable of ethical behaviour. Yep, definitely. So the reason why I'm raising these particular things is, while it's not all-encompassing in terms of being able to determine love through ethical behaviour, it will remove a lot of unloving behaviour if you begin this process of engaging ethical behaviour. It will remove from your soul, or confront in your soul, when you're being unethical. And we can give many practical examples, which I'd like to give through this discussion, of how often unethical behaviour is engaged without people even realising it. How many of you yesterday did do an interview with the National Geographic team? Can you just put your hand up? So 1, 2, 3, 4 of you. You actually engaged in allowing them to be unethical with you yesterday, right? Without knowing, right? We'll talk about that in a second, and that's something we're addressing with them. But I would like to discuss with you how that occurred. Many of you engage in unethical behaviour with your children in particular. In other words, you expect your children to do things that you don't expect of yourself. Now, we often use that example of, you know, a man who's smoking saying, "Don't smoke, and if you smoke, I'm going to punish you," to their child while they're themselves smoking. Now, that is a form of unethical behaviour directed at the child. And many times we engage in unethical behaviour with our children. Oftentimes, yesterday, remember during the discussion yesterday, I encouraged parents to restrict the behaviour of a child who is being unloving. Remember, I encouraged that. Well, as soon as a parent begins doing that, they're often triggered by guilt. And the reason why is because they themselves would be very upset with another person restricting them in the same manner, under the same circumstances. Does that make sense? So in that regard, if I restricted my child for something that my child did that was unloving, while at the same time expecting my own personal freedom for the same unloving behaviour, then I am being unethical. Can you see that? There is many recommendations that I've made in terms of how to deal with other people that often we are involved in unethical behaviour with, because often what happens is I make a discussion, I talk about, you know, for example, we talk about emotional demands that are placed upon other people. And so what we do is we look at all the other people who are placing emotional demands upon us. So when I'm discussing a matter regarding emotional demands or unloving behaviour, I'm trying to assist each person in the audience to reflect upon their own behaviour. But most people don't. What most people do instead is they reflect upon how that material affects the behaviour of other people towards themselves, without reflecting upon their own behaviour towards other people. That is unethical. It's unethical for me to consider Mary's behaviour towards me, for example, in a relationship, without me considering my own behaviour towards Mary on exactly the same matter. That would be an unethical thing for me to engage. But quite often we engage it. We actually say to people, you know, "You're now doing this," or "You're now doing that." And right at the moment that we're pointing the finger at them, we are engaged in unethical behaviour. Because quite often, right at that moment, we are angry with them or upset with them for what they're doing, and we're not, you know, engaging our own emotions appropriately. And quite often in that very moment, we are engaged in the unethical behaviour that we are criticising the other person for doing towards ourselves. Does that make sense? Yeah. Mary, and then we'll go up to... Yeah.
So just from what you said before, it seems to me that we can never be loving if we aren't first ethical,
mm-hmm.
but we can be...
We can be even more loving.
Yes.
By extending the ethics to another place. Yes. And extending the ethics to another place is not demanding of other people what I am willing to give them. So in other words, yes. I'm willing to give them love even if they hate me. I'm willing to give them love even if they're angry with me. I'm willing to give them love even if they don't accept me, they don't approve of me, and they try to make my life a living hell.
Yes.
That is an extension of pure ethical behaviour, but that is the next step. The first step is at least equal behaviour, where what I engage in with you is exactly what I expect or would like you to engage in with me.
Yeah. I think what is coming up for me is about barter, mm-hmm. because many people just engage that from a very intellectual addiction-based place, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
And they say, I'll give this to you, you give it to me, and then we're good.
But often that's not honest.
Ethical.
No, but it's not also honest.
Yeah.
And like most barters do not involve exchanging the same thing. If we look at the barter system, of any barter system, emotionally in particular, most bartering does not involve the exchange of exactly the same thing. For example,
yeah,
I want your approval, right? And I will give you your approval.
If you make me feel safe.
It doesn't matter what the reasons. It's sort of like, for example, if I want your approval and I'm willing to give you approval, so if I want your recognition of approval, for things that I do that are worthy of approval, and therefore I would also at the same time hopefully be willing to give you approval for the things that you are worthy of being approved of. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
If I had an ethical nature. Yeah. However, most of the time when it comes to approval, that's not what we do. We want approval from the other person without giving them any, right? And what we do is we enter the barter with a person who's willing to receive no approval but is willing to give it, right? And this is the problem, is that most barter systems are not ethical in their behaviour right from the beginning. They might outwardly appear ethical, but they are certainly not ethical in terms of the exact requirement of what we want from another person and what we expect to be able to give them. So I would even argue most of the time that we are in unethical behaviour when we are bartering emotionally with another person.
Yeah.
Because we're not expecting the same thing we're giving, we're expecting something different.
Yes.
So in other words, a woman who gives to her husband sex wants safety in return.
Yeah.
She's not wanting sex in return.
Yes.
She's wanting safety in return.
Yeah.
And so she is not in an ethical relationship with her husband under those circumstances. If she was willing to give sex for the sake of getting sex in return, now she's in an ethical relationship with her husband.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. No, that's clear.
And if she was willing... but if she wants power and the way she gets power is by giving sex, now she's in an unethical relationship with her husband. She gives him sex in order to have power over him, and he gives her the power. That is an unethical relationship now, which is what the normal bartering system does.
Yes. Yeah.
So I would say that the majority of times when we're in a bartering system with family members, with people in our household, with friends, with workmates and colleagues and so forth, most of the time we're in a bartering system that is not ethical. At least if we were in a bartering system that was ethical, we'd become more loving.
Yeah. And it just reminded me of something I read last week. It was a quote from Harriet Lerner, an author, and she said, if only we would listen to others with the same passion and desire that we want to be heard.
Exactly.
And that's been with me all week, like how much am I listening? And
exactly.
Yeah, because I want to be heard. Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
So unfortunately, people who want to be heard very rarely listen to others very
exactly,
much at all,
yeah.
Because the demand they have going out towards others is, I want you to listen to me. I don't want to have to listen to you.
Mm.
So that is an unethical demand.
Yeah. And very often we want someone to receive our facade.
Yep.
But we want the real them from them.
Exactly.
And that's unethical.
And that's unethical too.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
If we go back to Avira.
This is confusing me a lot.
Can I firstly make a statement about yesterday's talk and today's?
Yep.
Yesterday, when I presented the two columns of information about intellectual reasoning and emotional reasoning, during that phase, many of you felt confused or at least detuned from the discussion. Can I just say something to you about confusion? Confusion always results from fear and a desire to not understand coming from the soul on the actual issue. Does everyone get that? It's very important to understand this, because every time, I've often said this and I'll state it again, love is logical. Since it is logical, it can never result in confusion without there being some kind of opposition in the soul to love. And so we need to understand that every time we feel an intellectual difficulty in understanding something, that it begins with an emotional difficulty in understanding the same thing. Does that, everyone gets that? So if you can continue with that.
I actually realise that.
Yeah, that's good, that's good.
When I apply my logic to this,
yes,
I feel like I've been ethical, but I've been judgmental and critical and...
So let's look at the first one that you raised, judgmental. So if you tell me what you feel you've been...
Critical.
Yep.
Demanding.
Yep.
Angry.
Yep. Angry. This is in your sort of relationship with other people. Is that what you're saying? Yep. Yep. Shall we start with those four?
Yeah, I think that's enough.
We'll get the general gist by the time we get to the fourth one. All right. Now, that means when I'm judgmental, under this statement here, I'm saying, would I like to be treated judgmentally by other people?
I'm not up to that bit of it. I mean in terms of, like, I'm judgmental of me, so I'm applying the same...
I don't know, but so I'm not... This isn't about you. This is about how you treat others. Do you like other people judging you?
No.
How do you feel about that? So when other people judge you, how do you feel?
Well, sometimes I feel like I deserve it.
Sometimes, but most of the time, what do you feel? Most of the time, when other people judge you...
I actually sway between, oh, I did something wrong, I deserve it, and, oh, that's not fair, that's not right.
That wasn't the question I asked. The question I asked was, do you like it?
No, I don't.
I don't like it. Right, that's all we've got to say. I don't like it. If I don't like it, then I'm being unethical doing it. So unless you love having judgment aimed at you constantly,
okay,
then you would be ethical if you actually aimed judgment at other people constantly. That would be ethical if you loved receiving it yourself.
Right? Oh, I see. I get
Do you understand the slant? This is very different to what other people actually do. It's what you would like them to do. It's a very different state as well. Right? So we're not talking about what other people actually do to you. We're talking about what you would like other people to do to you, which is not the same thing, you see.
But in the beginning bit you said, like, if you're doing to other people what you expect for yourself or do to yourself.
No, I didn't say do to yourself.
No.
I said what you do to them. Very different. Okay.
So what you like somebody to be doing to you...
What you would like somebody to be doing to you, if you want to, if it's ethical, it'll be ethical to do the same thing to them.
Oh, I see.
It's not ethical to do a different thing to them.
Yep, I get it.
Do you understand? Yep. It's very, very different to what most people initially interpret when they see the statement, you see. So when it comes to judgmental... You don't like being judged, but you're willing to judge. So on that issue, you're not being ethical and therefore being unloving. You don't like being criticised, particularly if it's not constructive criticism or, you know, you don't like to be unjustly criticised, shall we call it, like criticise things you didn't do or feel you didn't do or whatever, then don't do that to them, right? Because you don't like it. You measure everything by what you like. If you do that initially, you'll find a lot about love, because what you like is often loving. It's not what you do that is often loving. It's what you like to have done to you that's often loving. Can you see? It's like, when it comes to being demanding, do you like other people being demanding with you? If I said, Vera, stand up now. Vera, sit down now. Vera, do this. Vera, do that. You know, after a while, even probably the first request, you probably wouldn't accede to, right? Because you don't like having anything demanded of you. So is it right then to demand something of another person? Of course not. It's not ethical. When you get angry with other people, how do you like other people being angry with you? Do you like other people screaming at you and yelling at you and telling you things about, you know, in a rage? No. So then how can you say that being angry with another person is ethical?
I get it now.
Can you see? Yep. As I said, by the time the fourth thing comes, you will see. It's all to do with what we like or don't like, not what we get. There's a big difference between those two things. You see, what other people dish out to us is often what we don't like. And I'm not saying do the same to them as what they do to you. We're saying do the same to them as what you would like them to do to you. Very, very different principle. We're not saying do to them as they do to you, as some Bibles have actually shortened it to, right? Not saying that at all. That is not an ethical thing to do. Because ethics involves your emotions, your feelings. If you feel something that you want from another person, then how can you expect to not give that to that person that you're expecting the same thing from? Would I like to be treated in the manner in which I am treating the other person? That's the question. And most of the time, the answer is no. Right? So, you know, when somebody comes up to you and they start talking, they don't let you get a word in edgewise and everything else, they just talk, and you feel like just being barraged upon. You felt that with people? Yeah. So how did you find that? Did you like that? No. So then when you do it with another person, is that ethical? Definitely not. Can you see the relationship? It's to do with what you would like them to do to you. So let's say you would like them to... some people are like this, some people are injured enough that some people do like another person to just be in their face all the time. Then what you would do if you were ethical is you'd be in the other person's face all the time as well. And you'd soon find out what they feel about that, wouldn't you? Very rapidly, in fact. And therefore, you would understand that what you want is obviously is a demand and that other people don't want, so there's something wrong. There's something going on in terms of what you think you like. The interesting thing about this issue of ethics treating it in this manner, is you will rapidly find out what other people don't like and what you don't like. You will also rapidly find out, therefore, what feels unloving for other people and yourself. Does that make sense? Very, very powerful way of becoming more loving, just by understanding that main principle. Okay. Is there any questions about it?
Just on the thing about barter, so you're saying that the world's got it all wrong when it comes to bartering, because just say, for example, I take it to like a trade and a painter barters...
Like a physical trade.
Yes, so a painter barters with a carpenter to get something, right?
Yes.
But a painter wouldn't trade with a painter.
Yeah. Why wouldn't he? Why would he train with a painter when he
can do it himself? So bartering, the way you're saying, is it's all wrong because...
Well, it's all unloving.
Unloving, yeah.
It's expecting something from another person that you are not willing to give them.
Yeah.
So, see, this is why a barter system in the long run won't work. A gift system is the only thing that can work. A gift system is different. A gift is, I'm a painter and I would love to give you the gift of me painting.
Without anything back.
Without anything back, yep. And that would prompt, usually, a feeling of, wow, appreciation and other feelings within yourself. And if you had anything that you felt that I might need, that would later probably prompt you to feel like, oh, I'd love to give to...
But see, I grew up in a European family. Mm-hmm. Whatever you do, if you do it out of giving without anything in return, they feel so bad and they feel like they are obligated to give you something back.
And the reason why people feel bad when you give them gifts is because they then feel obligated to return, and they don't know how to receive a gift. And we have not been taught as a society how to receive a gift. Does that make sense? As a society generally, we have not been taught how to receive a gift because we've been taught from a very, very young age that if anybody gives you a gift, you have to give them something in return. That's what we've been taught. You look at Christmas time. How many times have you ever been given a gift at Christmas time where somebody gives you a gift and you've forgotten to buy them one? How often do you see the reaction to that is, firstly, your own guilt? You feel terrible. How could I have forgotten them? And all these other things, you feel this terror. And they themselves often feel anger. Where's my present? And which actually triggers the fact that they weren't giving to you in the first place. They were demanding something from you in return. Now, if you were in a true gift-giving society, what would happen? I would give a gift without any expectation of any return. Right? So, in other words, we'd have a Christmas tree and I could give a gift and to people who have not given a gift to me, and we'd all be completely happy. In fact, the receivers, instead of feeling guilt, which is a fear-based emotion, would be happy to receive. And their joy would be multiplied by the fact that they're happy to receive and not in guilt about receiving the gift. Do you understand? So a true society, and if we take the painter analogy in a minute, but the true society wouldn't be focused on bartering. They'd be focused on gift giving. Let's look at how that might work in a practical example. Farmers produce a lot of our food. Is that not correct? Many of us live in high-density cities, not able to produce the food for ourselves. And farmers live in low-density areas. Often they have land that they're able to use to produce food. So many of the farmers also enjoy doing that as a job. They enjoy being on the land, working on the land. And if you've ever done it yourself, you'll realise why. Because you feel a deep connection to the land, a deep connection to the things around. And there's a lot of joy you can receive when you're in that place of farming. We as a community expect the farmer to pay for the implements that he farms with. Right? This is an amazing and very stupid and idiotic thing for us to expect, actually. We should be giving him the implements to farm with. He is producing one of our essential items, food, without which we won't have very much long-term survivability. Is that not agreed? And yet, instead of helping him do that for us, we ask him to pay for doing that for us. Now, of course, the farmer then, in receiving this demand, then feels like he wants to be paid for his service. Many of the farmers would be very, very happy to produce all the food that they want, that their land could produce, for free, if they had being given everything they need to do such a thing. Many of the farmers would be totally happy to do that. In fact, I know personally many farmers who would be very happy to do that. Right? Many persons who are in their passion on the land, wanting to grow things for other people, wanting to do things for other people, would be very, very happy to receive a heap of things, fuel and seeds and equipment to do this for you, for society. And they'd just feel an immense joy of not having to worry about money ever again, right? Ever again. If it's a bad year, they don't have to worry about paying off any debt. They don't have to worry about paying off any land. They don't have to worry about paying off any people. Because all of the things they need, even during a bad year, are going to be supplied to them because they have this desire to produce our food. Now, that is a gift-giving society where the farmer is wanting to give the gift of his effort to society, and society wants to give the gift of all the tools and implements and all the resources and everything else he needs to get that done. You imagine that society in comparison to the society that we live in today. A society we live in today is an economic society based on the bartering system, if you think about it. It's like paying for resources. So the people who produce the tractors get fed at some point by the farmer, and yet they want the farmer to pay for the tractor that they that the farmer then uses to produce the food that the guy who made the tractor needs to live. Now, that all could be circumvented if we had a gift-giving society. But to have a gift-giving society, we've all got to be far more trustworthy and trusting than we currently are. Right? If we have a barter society, what we finish up with is the painter and the carpenter negotiating. The painter says, I'll do 3 days' work for you, you do 3 days' work for me. Now, 3 days' work for the painter might result in half the wall being done, whereas 3 days' work from the painter might result in a whole house being painted. Right? And so how do we evaluate its worth? It's impossible to evaluate its worth properly and realistically. However, if the painter gives the gift of his time to the person, and the painter at the same time received all of the things he needed to do it, like food, shelter, clothing, paint, resources, whatever he needed to do the job, then he wouldn't be worried about how much it costs. If he was happy to paint, he'd just be happy to paint. And if he's not happy to paint, he'd find another job that he's happy to do. Right? And people argue with me a lot about the fact that this isn't a practical thing in an environment, in a social environment. Well, I'd argue that all through the spirit world, this is exactly what happens for a start. So there's many social environments in the spirit world, and this is what happens. So I don't agree that it's not a practical thing. Secondly, if you look at what we're currently doing is crazy. We are currently paying, you right now are paying for essential things that you need for your very life to be sustained. For example, you are paying for your water. Here in the city, you are paying for your water. Without water, you'll die, right? And yet you're paying for it. You're paying for your food. Without food, you'll die, right? Particularly if we've got emotional injuries that cause us to eat a lot more. We'll definitely pass in a very quick time without food. So without those two resources, we'll die, and yet we have to pay for them. In fact, you look at how much of your so-called budget per week goes towards those two resources, less so towards water. Although if you're looking at drinking water, like water that's actually tasting nice to drink, then the average person would need around 3 to 4 litres a day if we were honest with ourselves and looked after ourselves. That's around a dollar. It's about a dollar. The cheapest water you can buy is about a dollar a litre, right? So we're talking $4 a day times by 7 days, $28 a week. If you've got a family of four, $120 a week for good water to drink. Right? Now, this is why many of us don't drink good water. We drink the water that's been treated and has got all chemicals in it through the treatment process and so forth, because it just costs too much to even buy decent water to drink. Then let's look at what we eat. How many of us would spend a good couple of $100 a week at least on food? If you look at, particularly for a family, you'd be looking at probably $300, even $400 a week on food easily in some cases, right? You add those two resources together, there's, let's say there's, on the average, $400 to $500 if you actually paid for your water, there'd be $400 or $500 of your resources per week that would go on food and water to essential things for your life. We haven't even talked about shelter yet, or clothes, which are also needed, particularly in a cold environment, right? But just those first two things. Now, how much wage do you actually earn, the average person? Well, let's say in Australia, the average wage, which is very different from the lowest person's wage, but the average wage might be around $50,000 per annum, let's say, right? Take out taxation, now it's $40,000 per annum, or $42,000 per annum. And then if you look at $600 per week, how much is that up to? $600 per week, 52 weeks in a year, how much is that? It's about $30,000 per annum. So now you've got $10,000 per annum to do the other things, other than the essential things for your life.
Shelter and clothing.
Right, and when you think about that, you've now got to include shelter and clothing in that other $10,000 and so forth. Can you see why most people are finding it very, very difficult to make ends meet? And therefore, what do they feel? Huge amounts of fear about money. right? This is part of the problem. And the reason why is because we're all engaged in this barter system. The whole world is engaged for centuries, for millennia actually. This bartering system has been engaged because none of us are capable yet, emotionally capable of moving from that system to a gift-giving system. And when I say emotionally capable, we're not emotionally capable of becoming more loving, it seems. For many, many millennia, for thousands and thousands of years, we've not been emotionally capable of moving from this low development society where everybody barters with each other constantly and tries to get as much for as little as they can, to a gift-giving society where we're willing to give everything without getting anything in return. Completely the opposite mentality and completely the opposite development in love is required for those two states. When we enter a gift-giving system, a gifting system, we are now even behaving even more ethically, because we no longer have demands upon other people, right? So we're now in a very ethical transaction with another person. We're doing for them exactly what we would love them to do for us. So that is a very highly ethical proposition and therefore a highly ethical society. Now, we are capable, with our mankind's intellect, we are capable of developing this kind of society. We are capable of its development as long as we address the emotional impediments inside of us that cause us to be so unloving as to be resistive to such a society. We have the intellectual cleverness and the capacity to love that would allow us to do it. But it's a matter of developing ourselves in such a manner that eventually gets whole groups of people into that condition. So the beauty of examining this question of ethics, and the reason why I'm sort of starting to raise these subjects of love in action, like how does love look like when it's acted upon, is because it helps you start to analyse what's happening inside of yourself that causes you to not be able to act in the manner that would be more ethical and therefore more loving. And it causes us to be more circumspect regarding yourself. Now, I'm not suggesting you need to punish yourself for your past behaviour and inaction. Right? So I'm not suggesting we need to do that. What we need to do instead is to love ourselves enough to move from the unethical behaviour that we currently get involved in into a place of higher ethics and therefore higher love. Now, this matter is immaterial of whether we want to connect to God or not. The only way for our society to actually develop further is for all of us to change the way we view society and our demands upon it. That's the only way it's going to become better than it currently is. We can continue doing exactly the same thing that we're currently doing, and then we will end up with exactly the same results as we have ended up with for thousands of years. Do those results appeal to you? Do you like the fact that you spend $500 a week of your money having to live? Right? Do you like the fact that you, if you don't earn that $500, you feel stressed, fearful, afraid of the outcome, afraid of what's going to happen to you, and afraid of your life? Do you like that? Well, if you don't like that, why are we doing it? We need to change what we do. Can you see? So we need to become more developed even in our logical way of looking at life. Can you see that? And the reason why we are not more logical is because there are emotions in us that prevent us from becoming logical. Right? We often view everything as normal as what we currently have. It's like what we raised yesterday. Remember, I started talking to you yesterday about what we view as normal with regard to ourselves and then what God views as a mess in comparison to normal. Yeah, and we need to also see it from society. What we view in society as normal. So it is normal to pay in society. It is normal to pay for your water. It is normal in society to pay for your food. It is normal in society to pay for your shelter. Is it normal in society that if you're distressed, that you pay for your medical? You can even be therapist. You can even be dying and you still have to pay for your medical.
You could die in your family.
No, this is true, isn't it, in our society. We can be dying and we're still going to have to pay for our medical. Right? Somebody's going to have to pay for our medical because that's demanded of us. Right? Our clothing. Right? All essential items, right, for a society that's developed. And yet every one of those things we have to pay for. And because we have to pay for it, we now expect everybody else to have to pay for anything we supply. Can you see that? If I've got to pay for water, then of course I want you to pay for water. And if I've got to pay for shelter, then I want you to pay for shelter. And if I create your shelter, I would definitely want you to pay me for your shelter. But these are all essential items. It doesn't make sense in a developed society, right? In any developed society, it doesn't make logical sense that we pay for these essential items. I can understand you paying for non-essential items. So, for example, you want a piece of art on your wall. Well, your wall can exist and you can exist without a piece of art on it. And if you want a piece of art on your wall, I can understand that you might need to pay for that piece of art to be placed on your wall from somebody who will make that piece of art. I can understand that you might need to pay for music. You are totally capable of creating your own music. And if you want music from another source, then I can sort of understand why a developed society might ask you at some point to pay for that music, particularly if it uses a lot of resources to create. But I do not understand in a developed society why we have to pay for our medical, our shelter, our food, our water, and our clothing. And our funeral. Our death. Well, the reality is that the energy needed to produce all of these things is freely abundant to all of us. That's the reality, right? And the earth itself has methods that we can use to produce this energy. We receive enough energy from the sun to do all of these things. Is that not true? To provide for all of these things for free. And yet we don't. And we think we're developed. We think we actually are logical. And I'm saying, definitely not logical, and we're definitely not developed if we think that paying for this makes any sense logically or ethically. It doesn't make any ethical sense that a person has to pay for their own medical expenses. You think about the ethical. How would you like it? You're incapacitated, your leg's broken, you can't work, you can't do anything, right? And then have to pay for the fact that your leg's broken after you've also been laid up for 6 weeks and unable to do anything. Now, I can understand why a person might need to pay for self-destructive medical expenses. In other words, if a person drinks himself into oblivion and then has to have his liver removed or kidneys, you know, replaced through some donor process, then I can understand completely why he should have to pay for that particular operation. I do not understand why an accident would be something that we'd need to pay for. Now, I know in the end that you could argue that the law of attraction has brought you the accident and there's all these emotions involved in the accident and there are ways to deal with all of that in an ethical society. However, if we love other people, no matter what accident has befallen them, we'd want to help them, would we not? And we wouldn't want to add to their burden by now asking them to pay for us helping them, right? Now, so these particular things. Now, anybody who provides any of these particular things should be given all the resources and everything they need to provide these things. We shouldn't demand in a society that is logical and ethical, we should not demand that any person who supplies any of these things actually has to pay for anything to do so. Because these are all essential things that we need in society. We need enough water, food, shelter, medical attention, clothing, and funerals to be happening. because these are all a fact of our current life. Now, I'm not saying they're a fact of our future life, but what I'm saying is that they are a fact of our current life, and we could easily raise the entire consciousness of mankind by just changing the way we do a few things with those basic particular things that we need. Right? So there would no longer be sweatshops where they get paid $1 a month or $1 a week to produce your clothes. They'd be given all the food they need, all the clothes, all the material they need, all the things that they need, all the equipment they need, all the tools they need to produce your clothes if they wanted to produce your clothes. Because that is ethical. We would be doing for them what we would like to be done to ourselves. Yep. It's also logical, if you think about it. Why would you want something that you desperately need from another person, such as water or food, and then force the person who's producing such a thing that is essential for your own life to actually pay for doing you the service? Why would you ever want that? It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. So my feelings are that we are totally capable as a human race to change what we do from this unethical bartering, economical bartering system that we currently have, into a purely ethical, particularly with the basic essentials of life, into a purely ethical delivery of services that we're able to achieve as a human race. We're totally capable of this. It's just whether we want to do it enough or not, as to whether we'll do it. But we are totally capable of it.
Hi. It's all okay listening to it, but how do we start as a society to do all these things?
I was waiting for someone to ask that very question.
Or as an individual, really?
We have to change our way of feeling as an individual, firstly. We need to start with ourselves. I cannot expect water to be provided to me for free while I'm demanding that whatever I provide to the world isn't for free. So in other words, I've got to stop this whole concept of working for a wage inside of me. Right? Now, I've stopped it inside of me. I don't work for a wage, as you know, right? What happens with myself and what I've been trying to show you through my example is that I give you talks or all the things I love doing are given to you for free. Now, a lot of times people, because of their appreciation of the things they're receiving, they give me some money that which Mary and I can live on. And it's just wonderful. I feel our life is just so amazingly wonderful because I get to do exactly what I want all the time, and yet other people give me enough funds to do it. They also give me more funds than that, and so all of that funds that I get in addition, I give back to them. So by producing DVDs, doing more things that I'm capable of doing. I'm actually hopeful in the future that I could have a team of people, like a team of 20, 40, 60 people providing all these same services all over the world and eventually 100, 200, 500, 1,000 people. Right? That's how much I would love to receive in order to be able to give all of those things. I'd love to receive a lot more than I'm currently receiving so that I could use all of that because my life's happy. I would like to help a lot more other people's lives to be happy in the same manner, that they're doing things for other people in the same manner and receiving appreciation in the same manner. Eventually, we'll get to the point where it won't even be monetarily based. It'll be like, we get all the food we need, we get all the clothes we need, we get all the shelter we need, we go from place to place. Who cares whether you even have a home after that? You know that you're just going to be doing what you like doing in any direction, and there'll be somebody there who loves it enough that they'll want to give you something in return to look after these basic necessities. But for that to occur in society, I have to first change. I have to first do it, right? So a lot of people who have businesses ask me, well, how can I bring my business in harmony with God's love? My first answer to them is this. Don't charge anymore an hourly rate. Don't charge for your service anymore. You know what? Almost every person I know, there's a couple of people I know who've done that, But almost every person who has heard that doesn't take that very first step. The reason why is because they have got so many emotions in them that they can't do it, that they're not prepared to address those emotions and actually release that, right, and work through the issues involved. So I've had to do that myself, and I've done that many years ago, where I've released the emotions involved with that. And so that's why myself and Mary have this life now that we have, where we can go around doing all these different things, enjoying, you know, our interactions with everyone, helping everyone. We just get a lot of joy out of all of that. And on top of that, we get a lot, so much appreciation that we're able to survive without having to go out to work. Mary is an occupational therapist, and she could go out to work and earn 60, 70 grand a year. I'm, which is probably, if you're full-time, probably a bit more than that, right? It depends where. Yeah, and for myself, like I was earning $600,000 a year before I began doing this. So I'm capable of earning a lot more money than I'm currently earning, doing something I don't like, right? As are many of you, capable of earning things that you don't, from your, what you don't like. But the life we live now, we have about $1,500 to $2,000 a month that we utilise for ourselves. In terms of our food and our clothing, we've paid for our shelter, so our shelter's not needed anymore. And the rest of the money that we receive just goes straight back into delivering more of what we can do for everyone else. Because we don't need any more than that. But we don't even think about money as a result. Aside from, we sit down sometimes and have these little sessions of how can we best utilise those funds. So our bank account generally is close to zero. Every single week our bank account is close to zero. At the moment, we've just been given a donation from somebody that will enable us to produce like probably 4,000 or 5,000 DVDs, right? So all we're doing is just we get those donations and away we go with that, producing it, because we don't need it. Our life's great. We don't need more ourselves, right? And once you start engaging this particular type of life, and you engage, you have to work in your passion as well. You'll find, and you engage this gift-giving kind of life, where you're giving the gift of your time to other people, you will find that it's just incredibly satisfying, and you will have changed, and you're living in a society that hasn't changed yet. So myself and Mary, Kate, are able to still live in this society that hasn't changed, which is not focused on gift-giving, it's focused on bartering. And the main reason why is because people's hearts are involved in the exchange, and when their hearts are involved in the exchange, they feel appreciative. And so we end up getting all the things we need as a result. So that's how you do it. You take the first step of changing how you earn your money yourself. It's very confronting. Almost every person I know who I've said that to has not changed that first step. Right?
So is it to deal with the emotion of why you have to work for a wage?
Honestly, when it comes to money, we have a large number of emotions associated with money and the reason why we do what we do. The largest emotion that we have is fear. We are afraid that the bills that we have and the other things will not get paid. We're afraid of being put in jail. We're afraid of having to declare bankruptcy and then what will we do? We're just so afraid. We're afraid of everything. We're afraid of how it looks. We're afraid of, you know, how it looks to other people. We're afraid of where we're going to get the money from. We're afraid of how we're going to live, how we're going to eat, how we're going to sleep, where we're going to sleep if we don't have all this money coming in. Fear is our primary reason. Once you confront this issue of bartering in financial world, you realise that you've got a lot of fear, a lot more fear than you ever realised you had before. Because we now accept as normal all this fear. And so what we do is when we go out and earn the money, we're really pandering to the fear. We're really saying, this is the only way I can make this fear go away, right? So what we do is we make the fear go away by action. So we take action to make the fear go away, and the action we take is to go and get a job we don't like and work in it for 40 hours a week, that we don't want to work in it for 40 hours. We'd probably prefer 20 or 25 or whatever it is. But and to be frank, if it's a job we don't like, we probably want to work at 0 hours. You know, for most of us, if we had a job we liked, what would we do? Would you care about whether you worked 100 hours a week if it was what you loved doing? You wouldn't, would you? Like, you go, what do you mean work? What, I'm not working. Like, myself and Mary don't think going around doing all of this is work. Because it's not. Like, for us, it's just like, no, this is our joy and our passion. How could you even view it as work? Right? And the reality is the majority of us are not willing to even find something we desire to do that passionately, where we're willing to take the risk of losing everything to do. So there's so many fears. So when you first confront the emotion inside of yourself of why you do everything for money, the biggest emotions will come up relating to fear. And of course, fear suppresses desire. So every time you're afraid, you're going to go, oh no, I don't really think I'd like that particular job. You know, you convince yourself things that are not true when you're in the state of fear. Like, so you go inside of yourself and you go, no, you know, oh yeah, I'd really like to do music, but I don't want to do it that bad that I'm broke doing it, right? I'd really like to do art, you know, that's the thing I'm passionate about, but I'm no good with it, you know, I don't do it good enough to sell, right? That's what we initially start out with as well, this whole idea that you're not good enough, nobody's going to pay for it and all these kind of things. And these are all just fears that we have, long lists of them that we can address by just doing a few basic things with our life and taking action. So that's what I would do.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's what I've done. So I can say, and I can say it works because I've done it.
Yep. Just on that, with the, what if you're in a, you say for me, so for music, for example, mm-hmm. People won't even let me do a gig unless I give them a fee. Or like with the school that I'm working at, I had to come up with a fee, otherwise I wouldn't be able to be in that desire in that school, because it's part of the ethics of the world at the moment that I need to have a fee in that school.
Yeah, and I'd just say to them, well, look, you're going to have to work through that issue. I'm perfectly here. I'm willing to give the gift of my time for free, and I'm willing to do it for free. But the reality is I also need to live, and so I can't do it for free if I don't receive anything. So you're going to have to work out what you feel it's worth.
Yeah, I've done that, so it's been okay, but I'm just thinking, you know, some people
you
won't
think
even
what
let
we
me
do in these presentations. What do we do? Like, the reality is the truth I'm giving you is like most of you have never heard it before because it hasn't been presented before on Earth, right? Secondly, it's going to affect your entire life. Is it not? Like, everything in your life is going to be affected by the things I'm presenting to you. So an essential, like, divine truth is on there as an essential, right? I said to Mary yesterday, I said, I find it really, really interesting. I said, the very thing that is the most essential thing in everybody's life, they're already receiving for free. Yep. Already receiving it for free. And divine truth, you're already receiving for free. Isn't that wonderful? Right. So they are essential parts of your life. So the way I view it is like, this is an essential thing for everybody on the planet, divine truth. I've got to give it to everybody. And I had a lot of fear at the start, right? I had a lot of fears about even receiving. So what I did was got all of my money that I'd saved up through this process of working for 30 years before then, right? And what I did was I had money saved up, I had houses and other things, and I just sold them and sold them and sold them and used all that money to do it, right? 5 years later, what happened? I was broke because I'd used all the money and I hadn't worked through the receiving part of giving. I just felt terrible amounts of guilt about receiving anything. So I hadn't worked through that. When I had no money, now I had to work through that. I had to work through the fact that actually, why am I blocking everybody from giving back to me? Like, I had to work through that. What guilt, what emotions within me caused me to block that? I had to work through those emotions in order to be able to receive. Once I started working through those emotions, I started receiving enough eventually for myself and Mary to live on so that we could continue doing what we're doing. That's what you need to do. Exactly the same thing. Yep. Okay.
So I'm getting a picture of everybody living from their desire.
Mm-hmm.
everybody being in a space of giving and receiving unconditionally.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It kind of reminds me. Yeah. There's a book about warm fuzzies.
Yes.
And it kind of reminds me of the giving of love and warm fuzzies.
Yeah.
And those who get really possessive and fearful actually give out cold pricklies.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
That's what I remember. Yeah. Anyway, that's all I wanted to say.
Yeah, and that's very true. It's very true in terms of emotions. Very true. Very.
It's a good comment, isn't it? And that's what I was thinking before. Really, you're talking about a society that is, at the moment, we're just driven by guilt rather than gratitude. And when gratitude inspires us,
yep.
I mean, that's what happens now with you. As you said, people's hearts are involved. But guilt being the fear-based thing, it really...
When guilt inspires us, it doesn't inspire us. It really destroys our life.
Yeah.
When gratitude inspires us, it causes us to go in all sorts of directions that we wouldn't have imagined before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just going to share about the feelings that come up, because now I'm in the process of going through what you went through.
Yes.
So until now I've sort of been relying on you
yeah.
and carrying quietly all my money-based emotions.
Yeah, yeah.
And I made a decision at the start of the year that I wanted to address it.
Yeah.
And that affected our collective income or gifts or whatever.
Yeah, as soon as I disclaimed any responsibility for producing anything in our life, and I placed the responsibility on Mary to begin doing some of that, our resources went
yep.
from having a regular flow of funds where we could produce DVDs and send out things and all these other things to having nothing within the space of about a week. Because I spent everything. I spent everything I get. So it was all spent within a week and there was nothing coming in after that.
Yeah. So, and that was great because that showed me where I'm at.
Yeah.
Even though I felt a bit guilty. But
yeah.
But what I was going to say, you're talking about fear, and I know I have fear, but something that I'm seeing more and more is that I equate money with love.
Yes.
And I notice when I feel that I really give of myself in a presentation, I actually receive less donation, and that's triggering this feeling I have that if I give my real self, I won't receive love.
Yes.
And so it's just surprising what comes up when
through
you
process,
engage
yeah.
this process.
Yeah.
I really didn't. I thought it would be fear of not living or something.
Yeah.
And that doesn't seem to. It's all about just me. I'm not lovable.
As are all of our creations.
Yeah.
No, it's very true. So does everyone understand that with Mary? Like Mary began engaging this process of attempting to address the issues of why she felt she wasn't able to create and therefore felt limited by funds. So Mary has a lot of belief systems about money. She only wants enough. Oh, I want mega bucks. Right? The reason why I want mega bucks is I know exactly what I'm going to do with it. And I've already decided what I'm going to do with it. Like, it's not for me. Like, at the end of the day, it's not going to be for me. We're probably still going to live in our little two-bedroom home in 40 acres exactly the same way as we're always going to do. We're very, very happy there. And I can't imagine ever changing that. We don't need more personal resources at all than what we're currently getting. We don't need more at all. But I would love to have the funds to do huge amounts of things all over the earth. Like, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Of course. Of course you would. So I don't have those blockages of like, whereas Mary has all these blockages about, you've got some blockages about the responsibility of finances. Like, so Mary's got these issues with responsibility. She's got the issue of she wants just enough but not too much. She's got issues of being judged by the world if we have too much or what's perceived as too much. So all of these things prevent the reception of more in terms of gifts, prevent gifts from being given, you see, as a sole transaction. The problem with that is that we then have to go back to a barter system to survive, which is no good. Like, we want to be fully engaged in a gift-giving system,
and
which is ethical.
I don't want to do that because I do think divine truth is on that like,
yeah, God, I feel divine truth is on the list as
on
well.
On the list, yeah. But so I don't want to charge anyone.
I'll cross
for
it off the list because it's not essential for a physical life.
Yeah.
But it is essential for your emotional health and your long-term survivability all through the universe. But the things that are essential for your physical life surely should at least be available to you, and they surely should be given as gifts rather than expectations. Yeah. To engage such a life requires a lot of courage, doesn't it? To fully engage ethics in a right across the board in your life requires a lot of courage. And it did require a lot of courage for myself, and as Mary's finding out now as she's engaging the same emotions, it requires a lot of her courage as well. And it will require a lot of your courage to actually change, you know, and have the courage to deal with the fears that come up as a result. The beauty of doing it, though, is that it's so amazing, and this is something that I don't believe anybody in Western society really understands. It is so amazing to live a life where you don't even think about money at all. At all. So you go into a restaurant, right? And you don't ask yourself, how much is that? You just don't. You say, I want this, this, and that, and this, and the person says, you're sure? Yes, I'm definitely sure. That's exactly what I want. We go into shopping centres now, and you would have noticed this is a common thing happening lately in a shopping centre where you go to buy food. And some food is fairly expensive, right? And so you put, like, you know when bananas were expensive? You know, they were in Australia, they were here at, I think they were $12 or $13 a kilogram, somewhere around that figure, right? And I still went in and bought my 25 bananas that I buy every week, or 20 bananas or whatever it is that we buy every week. 20 bananas at $13 a kilogram works out to be, you know, $30 or $40, right? And they go, they look at you and go, do you realise that's $40 for your bananas? Yes, I do. And they look at you like you must be crazy or something. and then you say, and I still want to eat my bananas. It doesn't worry me how much that costs. I still want to eat my bananas. I love my bananas, you know. If you love things, that's what you'll do. And of course, when they're $1 a kilogram, I don't buy 30 because we only need 20, right? So I don't buy 30 because they're $1 a kilogram. I still buy 20. And they look at you then, you love bananas. Yes, that's right. But I can only eat 20 in a week, right? So I can only eat 20, yeah? Why aren't you buying 30? You know, the dollar kilogram now, you could buy $5 and you know, you could have 30. I don't need 30, I only need 20. I can't eat 30, right? So why would I buy 30? So it's immaterial to me how much it cost. Like, it's something that I love. It's an essential item, I feel, and in my diet. And so I buy it. Wouldn't you do the same if you did not care about money? You'd do the same, wouldn't you? If you had $1 million in the bank, now probably you'd care about money less. Right? Isn't that not the truth? So it's interesting, I find. We often think that we can enter a state of not caring about something when we've got more than enough. That's what we think. It's not so, right? The reality is I've seen millionaires still penny pinching, right? Because they have not yet emotionally even absorbed the fact that they're a millionaire now. Yep. I know millionaires who come along to our sessions who are still penny pinching in their day-to-day life. They won't buy certain things. They won't stay in certain places. They won't look at certain things because they're still worried about the money. They either feel guilt about having it now and therefore they don't spend it exactly what they want. And I'm not saying that you would then overuse the real world's resources either, because you would not. If you were just focused on what you need, you wouldn't then go out and buy 10 things because it's cheap. You would still buy one thing if that's all that you needed. Can you see that? You'd still do the same thing. Your behaviour would not change. Why does our behaviour change? Because we are afraid of missing out, which is another fear. That's why our behaviour changes. So when we've got the dollar bananas and we're afraid of missing out. You can only eat a certain number of bananas. But when we got the dollar bananas, we're afraid of missing out. And now that they're cheap, we can afford to buy more, so we buy more, right? And because we have all of these emotions associated with greed. Greed really is about when you can afford to do something. Greed is all about, I want to get as much as I possibly can right now, because if I don't get it right now, I'm too afraid that it might not be available tomorrow. Right? A person who lives in a state of ethical behaviour does not do that. A person living in a state of ethical behaviour will buy the same amount of bananas that he needs every week, no matter what their price is, because he will have some ethics about his personal love of self. They'll have ethics about other people, the environment. All these ethics will come into play. And every single one of these ethics will affect the behaviour. Does that make sense to everyone? Yeah. And it's such an important issue. It's like love in action is very, very, very interesting. It's often very different to what people think it is. And when we focus on loving ourselves, loving other people. Remember I gave some talks, it would be now, I think it was now a couple of years ago, about the laws of God involved in loving others and then the laws of God involved in loving yourself. The reality is we can challenge our emotional understanding of love quite rapidly in our life, right? We're just many of us too afraid to do so. So the reality is also that we are willing to talk about love until the cows come home, as the saying goes. We're willing to talk about love and talk about love, talk about love some more and talk about love some more without even engaging one aspect of love in our day-to-day life. You know why we're willing to do that? Because on one hand, our soul is screaming out to us going, you love love. You want to live in love. That's what your soul's saying. And on the other hand, your soul's also screaming out to you going, but you're terrified. I'm terrified of love. I'm terrified of how love is going to look like, how love is going to affect my entire life, how it's going to be in action. And so what I do is I've got these scales inside of myself, this internal scale system. On one side, I've got love, and then on the other side, I've got fear. Right? And what we finish up doing in our life is we finish up going, okay, I do want to love, but I don't want to love as much as my fear might get triggered. So I want to love, but I don't want to love that much that all of my fears are going to have to be given up. That's our problem as a society. It's also our problem individually. You look at how much individually we are having trouble with actually putting into action the principles of divine truth. Why are we having that trouble? The main reason why we're having the trouble is because fear is still the dominant emotion in our life. It's not so much that we have fear. Having fear is not the problem. Can you see that? The problem is that we live in it, in the fear. The problem is that we honour it. The problem is that we value it. That's the problem we have. Right? This causes us, these emotions, this honouring the value or living in fear causes us to act highly unethically. We have no ethics as a result of our fear. Because if you think about it, if we had some ethics and no fear, it would be so simple to be ethical, wouldn't it? We'd be able to just do it every day automatically. We wouldn't even worry, would we? We wouldn't be worried about, oh, but what about the money? Or what about this? Or what about that? Or what about how this looks? Or any of these other things, because we would be so focused on the fact that there is no fear, so we'd only be focused on the love part of the equation. That's all we'd be focused on. So life is a lot more simple like that, as you can imagine. See, at the moment, inside of us, it's really, I see this happening quite a lot inside of each person. Inside of us, we have this measuring system, just like the scales here. We have this measuring system that's going on constantly. We measure every possible action in our life as to whether it's going to create more fear in our life or not. That's the measuring system we use. Can you see that? And if we believe it's going to create a more difficult life, And we only have to believe it. It doesn't even have to be true. We only have to believe it. If we believe it, we now then take those actions and we do whatever the fear dictates. It doesn't even have to be true. We do it. That's our problem. And because we do that, and we've got this internal scale going, fear, no fear, fear, no fear, fear, no fear, fear, no fear, then of course we respond in addictions, which is also unethical. Right? We respond in addictions because we are so driven by our fear. So if you had to ask the question, what causes unethical behaviour? It's not your fear that causes unethical behaviour. It's your valuing fear that causes unethical behaviour. It's honouring fear that causes your unethical behaviour. It's not the fear itself. So many people I see using fear as an excuse. It's not fear that's the problem. It's your unwillingness to see that fear has no value that is the problem. It's your unwillingness to see that you're honouring fear. That's the problem. That's what causes all of your unethical behaviour. Every single time you honour fear, you are placing fear as your God. And the world is doing this. You know, a lot of people say the God of the world is money or the God of the world is whatever. No, the God of the world currently is fear. That's the God of the world. Because that's the thing that every single person on the planet generally responds to first. That's the thing, fear. They value it, they honour it, and because they value it and honour it, they live in it. Right? And the result of this fear is that it is the cause of all unethical behaviour on the planet. All unethical behaviour on the planet is caused by fear. So can you see that it's so important for us to stop honouring our fear and start honouring love? And this is what this statement does. This golden rule that I gave to people in the first century, that is what it does. It honours love over fear. Because it says, in treating others how I would like them to treat me, not how they treat me, but how I'd like them to treat me, I am now honouring love over any fear-based situation that can occur. So what if they want to kill me? How will I act towards them? Well, I don't want to kill them, and I don't want to be killed. So I would act in harmony with that. Does that make sense? That's how I would act. What if they wanted to destroy my life? How would I act towards them? Well, I don't want my life destroyed. So how could I consider destroying their life in return? I can't. Right? What if they wanted to torture me? How would I act? Well, I don't want to be tortured. So how could I ever consider torturing them? What if they wanted to shoot me? How would I act? Well, I don't want to be shot. So I certainly can't consider shooting them in return. What if they want to rape my wife? Right? How would I act? Well, I don't want my wife to be raped. Right? So I would not ever consider raping their wife or child in return. Can you see? It's like every single violent action that can be taken against me, if I do this, if I understand this principle, I could never take the action in return. What if I'm in a religion and they want to excommunicate me from the religion? Well, I don't want to be excommunicated. So why would I ever excommunicate another person? I don't want to be damned for the rest of my life, so why would I damn another person for the rest of theirs? I don't want to be criticised and judged constantly by other people, so why would I want to criticise and judge anybody myself? Can you see, you can go from the most extreme action a person can consider to the least extreme action that we consider, and if I'm applying this principle, I'm going to pretty much be loving in every situation because I'm going by what I would like to be done to myself. Right? And instead of to do that, I'm going to have to confront all of these fears that I have about doing that. Aren't I? So I'm going to have some courage. Courage is a very important quality to develop. And if I address these fears and I stop honouring and valuing my fear over all other things, I stop making fear my God. So that's no longer my God. And even if I don't believe in God, if I make love my God, I'm going to be better off. Can you see? I don't even have to believe in God. I can make love my God instead, and I am capable of changing my life. And then if you start actually accepting God and going through the process of all of those things and receiving divine love, it's easier then to love, and therefore I become more like God and more like love anyway. But I don't even have to do that if I really want to change. All I've got to do is stop honouring my fear as God.
Thanks. I live a very fear-driven life.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure how I start addressing that.
Well, what's one thing you're afraid of?
I clearly have money issues because I've got to the broke.
Okay.
So
you're afraid of something to do
with money. I'm afraid of being successful and having a lot of money.
Right. Okay.
I'm very afraid of relationships.
Yeah, I was going to say, these are very low on your list, really.
Yeah, okay. Let's cut to the chase. I'm really afraid of relationships, and I've just discovered recently that I'm extremely angry with men,
okay. Which
was a bit of a surprise.
Okay. So even a friendship with a man is going to be quite difficult if you're extremely angry with men, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so let's say you pick an area of your life, like you've done, where what you're really afraid of. You notice initially when we do that, we often pick areas that we're not as afraid of, and we list all of them first.
Yeah, we're just warming up to it.
We're really just warming up, right? Because there are often a whole area of a list of things that we are afraid of, but in terms of the real fears that we have, there are often what I would call my primary fears. And often when I start addressing my primary fears, my secondary fears are involved.
Okay.
So, for example, if security is a primary fear, so let's say security is a primary fear, and a secondary fear is money.
Yeah.
Right? And safety is a primary fear. And a secondary fear is, money.
Yeah.
You can see that these two issues are going to at some point intertwine with each other. They're going to some point relate to each other. So my suggestion with any person who's wanting to confront anything in their life is this. The best things to deal with first are not the secondary things.
Okay.
Because they will have a lesser effect on your life once you've dealt with them than these things. These things are having the biggest effect on your life. So doesn't it make sense logically to deal with the biggest things in your life first?
Yes.
Make sense? So what I would do is I'd go, okay, what are my biggest issues? So relationship is one of them. Okay. So that's one of your biggest issues. So that's one of the issues you want to focus on first.
Okay.
Right? So forget about the money issue for a while. When I say forget about it, go out and get a job and work to get enough of your stuff, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Don't deal with that issue just yet. Whatever needs to be done with your money, do it. Right? Even if it's not in a job that you don't like at this point, go and do that.
Yeah.
Because this is a gradual process of change, right? So do that, because that issue is not so big an issue for you as this issue. This is the issue you need to put most of your of your spare time.
I've pretty much hidden for 30 odd years.
Yeah.
In my house, not going out.
Yeah. So all of your spare time needs to go into this relationship issue. So what do you remember? This is a part of the experimentation process that we discussed yesterday. Yes. So what would I do to address by create? What experiments would I create to address this relationship issue in an ethical way, where I can begin? So it has to be an ethical way. So in other words, if I decided, I'm just going to go out and find a man, have sex with him, and then I'll start working through a relationship issue. Right. Does that sound very... Would you like a man to decide that with you?
No.
Right? Obviously not. You know, that's not very kind and it's not very... You're just getting used by somebody, which isn't very kind. So why would you then ethically do that with him? So you can't create an experiment that's unethical and therefore unloving. But what you could do is you could start finding places where men are, right? And decide to actually enter into friendships with these men and see how that process goes for you, couldn't you?
Yes.
That would be more ethical, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
To actually desire to get to know them, desire to what's going on for them, you know, desire to understand them, desire to... These are things you want from men, aren't they? Don't you desire a man to understand you and get to know you?
Absolutely.
And these are the ethical things that you this is the things you want from the man. So why don't give that to a man in a friendship environment initially?
Mm-hmm.
Right? But because to be a fried ship environment. And you explain to him right at the beginning if you wanted to. You could say, look, my problem is that I'm pretty angry with men. So I'm not sure that you're going to want to agree with this. But I'd like to get to know you, but I've got this problem. I'm not wanting to get to know you to have a physical relationship with you, like in terms of a sexual relationship with you. I just need to have a few men friends in my life so that I can... begin to interact with men and begin to understand men better and begin all the things that you want from men to do for you.
Yeah.
I can begin to understand men better. I can begin to, you know, understand what's going on and how men feel and think and so forth. And I'd like to engage, honestly engage, this kind of sort of friendship with you. Like, I don't want to engage a relationship because I'm not certain that I want to be with you.
Yeah.
Right? So I know that I can't engage a relationship with you. But I can engage a friendship with you. Now, would you be willing to enter into this kind of, you know, arrangement with me so that I can learn some things and who knows, you might learn some things too or you just might learn that I'm a bitch. But either way, we'll learn something, right, in the process. And if you approached it in that way, it'd be very honest, you're very open, very ethical. And what then I would choose to do is go to a place, this would be my experiment, go to a place where people are doing things that I love to do. So if I loved music, I would go to a place and look around at guys that are there in the place and music and I'd just approach them and say, look, you know, this is the issue I have. And sooner or later, one of them will respond in some way. Even if they tell you to get lost, they'll respond in some way, right? And a lot of times you can just even sit there in an environment and be approached by somebody else and you say, well, this is what I'm here for. You know, explain to them. Well, you don't even have to go up to them a lot of times. You can just sit there and you know, wait for them to come to you. But engage the process ethically. In other words, don't enter a relationship with them unless you desperately want to love them and, you know, you want to demonstrate that love. Don't enter into a sexual relationship with them unless you desperately want to give them sex and you desperately want to receive that from them and you desperately would like to love them. And when I say desperately, it's probably not the right term, but you'd love to, you want to love them and they want to love you. And don't do anything unless it's ethical. But choose to do it. Choose to address the fear. Now, when you begin addressing a fear that is a primary fear, remarkable things happen in your life because all the emotional reasons, all the emotions that you have related to the reason why you've been afraid of this particular thing in your life start to come up. And all of the beliefs that you have that are unloving and unwarranted in many cases start coming up. And all of the childhood history that you have that created these beliefs and emotions all start to appear, right?
Yeah.
And now you're in a process of engaging your biggest fears. And the beauty of engaging your biggest fears is if you release them, that no longer becomes a fear. And in fact, you'll find most of your fears become desires. So instead of fearing a relationship, you'll work through your fear enough to get to the point where you desire a relationship. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And that's a good sign that you've actually dealt with a lot of your fears once you start to actually, from your heart, desire something. Now, with some primary fears, they won't turn into desires. There'll be other primary fears that you have that won't turn into desires at all. They'll be transformed into something else. But you'll be amazed at how many times some of the primary fears that you have are actually, in the end, going to turn out to be some of your primary desires. And in fact, this is something that goes on inside of the soul quite frequently. Sometimes the things that we have the largest amount of fear associated with are also the things that we have the largest amount of desire and the largest amount of fear about our desire not being met. Yeah. And so this is why it's very good to engage the process. Now, once we engage that process, can you see if you just changed your fears associated with relationship, you will have helped yourself in your relationship with God.
Yeah.
You will have helped yourself in your relationship with your soulmate.
Yeah.
And you will have helped yourself in your relationship with others.
Definitely.
Which would include your family, your children, if you have any, and your friends. And on top of that, you will have helped yourself in your relationship with anybody who comes to you in your environment as a subsequent result of focusing your energy and attention on that one thing. What I see a lot of people doing is they know they have emotional issues inside of themselves relating to a specific subject, but they are in so much fear about that particular subject that they do not actively address the fear associated with the subject. And as a result of that, they remove the potential for growth from their life in that particular area. That potential is removed.
I realised that after looking at some of your DVDs. Yeah. I thought, oh, whoops, I've just hidden myself away very safely so that I don't ever have to feel that fear.
Yes. And that's the problem, is that we need to stop doing that. We need to stop hiding ourselves from things. So my suggestion is, and by the way, this is a very ethical thing to do. The reason why it's such an ethical thing to do is up until this point in time, what we do with our fears, the problem with having these fears, these primary fears in particular, is what we do with them is we expect our environment to conform to our fear. So in other words, we're asking everybody else to honour our fear as much as we honour our fear. Right? Now, is that ethical? Would you like everybody else around you to make you honour their fear as much as they did? Of course you wouldn't. But unfortunately, as a society, we generally do that with everyone around us. We're asking other people to honour our fear, to value our fear. You'll be surprised how many times, even in a presentation that I give, I get questions asked all related to fear. They want me to honour their fear as much as they do. And when I give an answer that challenges fear, you'll be often, well, not perhaps surprised, but often you'll notice their rage or anger because they do not want me to have a lower value on their fear than what they have. right? So what many people want from me is they want me to pander to their fear. So they don't want the truth. They want me to pander to their fear. Now, to be frank with you, if I pandered to everyone's fear, I'd be a very famous person. I'd be sort of like a Tony Robbins type of character who panders a lot to other people's fear. I'm not a person like that who panders to other people's fear because it's not ethical for me to do so. I don't want you to pander to my fear. I would like you to challenge my fear. Right? So it's not right for me then to pander to yours. I want to challenge your fear. Yeah? And I suggest that if you do that, choose the biggest things you fear in your life and work on those first. Because if you choose the biggest things you fear in your life and work on those first, you'll have the greatest change in your life at the shortest amount of time. Right? That's a very economical way of using your time. It's not economical to use your time in another direction, in fact. It's not economical for you to change a little tiny fear, right, while you leave these big fears unchallenged. It's far more economical in terms of the use of your own time and the use of your own resources, and the use of the resources of the world, in fact, will be far better used if you challenge your biggest fears first. Yeah. So it is actually an ethical action you can take by challenging your fears first, the biggest fears you have first. Joy, you.
How does God see fear? And when I'm honouring my fear, what happens to God's laws?
Well, as I've pointed out, when I honour my fear, I now have fear as my God. So if we look at who our God is, if fear is our God, how do you think God feels about fear? So what God sees is fear has become a competitor for God's emotions with his children. Fear has become the dominant factor in people's life. Now, God doesn't judge that, but God understands that fear is the result of the false expectations that appear real to society, right? In fact, God understands that the whole fear grew because of the walking away from God. Because if we hadn't walked away from God in the first place, then fear could never have grown to the extent that it has now. Because we'd have some level of trust that we have a mummy and daddy, God, who provide for us and look after us and accept us and love us and all of those kind of things. Does that make sense? So the beauty of it is that fear is the false expectations appearing real are not valued by God at all. So God doesn't value your fear. In fact, all of God's laws challenge your fear. Yeah? God doesn't value your fear at all. God doesn't say, oh, Joy, you've got such a terrible amount of fear in there that I'm going to honour your fear for a minute. No, God's going, no, I'm not going to honour a single fear inside of Joy for 1 minute. And don't you feel that when you start recognising a lot of God's laws and everything? You see the law of attraction at work there. Like, can you see the law of attraction honouring your fear? What does it do? With it exposes your fear every single time. As it's like, bang, there's my fear again. Bang, there's my fear. You're afraid of having an accident, you finish up having one. You're afraid of, you know, you're afraid of having a broken relationship, you finish up having one. And like the law of attraction just exposes your fears constantly. That's how God feels about your fear. He wants your fear to be gone completely. God also knows that there is no fear in true love. So God knows that there is no fear in true love. So if you really loved, even yourself, you would not be afraid. If you really loved God, you would not be afraid. If you really loved your soulmate, the other half of yourself, you would not be afraid. Fear is created because a lack of love exists. So, of course, God just wants you to help you wipe out your fear so there is no longer fear. And instead, what's just left is then true love. That's what God wants. God wants us to no longer honour our fear as God and honour God as God. Right? Honour your creator as God. Honour your creator as the person who is the source of your existence and the source of your life. And therefore, there's nothing to fear. That's what God wants us to do. But that all being said, God doesn't criticise you for your fear. God just knows that your fear is a figment of your own experience, and once you release it, you won't need to fear anything again. That's what God knows. Elvira? Thanks for running around for us.
It's all right.
I'm really angry at men and I'm really scared of men.
Angry at men and scared of men? Yes?
Yeah.
So similar emotions to...
Yeah. But through my teens and 20s, I had a lot of friendships with men. In fact, my best friends were men.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't understand the law of attraction of that. And the
other... Did you have relationships during that time?
Well, when I met my husband, I did.
Yeah.
But I feel like I've had a 26-year unethical marriage.
Right.
You know, both sides.
Yep. And that's often the case.
Yeah.
You know, when we're in a bartering system.
Yeah.
It's often the case.
And, like, I've been working to address those things.
Yep.
And been more honest with him, telling him I don't think he's my soulmate and asking him to think about, well, am I the right person for him, and opening up a dialogue about it.
Can I point to you out to you, though, that if, on this issue of you don't think he's your soulmate, how would you know?
Well, that's the thing. I don't know.
Exactly. So why say it?
Well, I said to him, because I thought, well, I've got to start being honest here.
Yeah.
And I said, look, I don't know. This hasn't been working the way we've been doing it. It's not working. I've been unloving to you.
But you remember you said, this is why I need to raise with you. Remember you said, I think you're not my soulmate. I just want to address this issue because it's an issue that's happening very regularly. Right?
Well, we've decided to stay together to try and work out whether we are or not.
Yeah, I understand. Yep.
Yeah.
But even this statement... is fraught with ethical problems.
Oh, okay.
Right? For a start, you're using your thoughts to determine something. As we've discussed yesterday, thoughts and feelings need to be involved, right, in terms of emotions of truth. Secondly, there is a need to experiment as to whether you're soulmates or not.
Yeah.
Is there not? You're in a relationship already, and before you leave this relationship, you need to experiment first. Rather than just thinking that he's not and stating that, you need to first experiment. Secondly, you've said that you're angry with men and that you're, you know, fearful of men. Now, obviously, that's going to be a major thing playing out in your relationship.
Yeah.
Right? So this is another part of the information that needs to be confronted. So it would be better, wouldn't it, to say something like, I would like to experiment with whether we're soulmates or not.
Well, that's basically the discussion we're having, but I'm wondering, like, if I'm...
When you say this to a person...
You
sound like you've already made a choice. You've already made a decision, and the decision is not based on any factual or logical evidence. It's only based on a thought. And so, therefore, like, presenting just thoughts like that is, like, of course going to have its own results... Particularly when you know that you're blocked to men and have been blocked to men for such a long time and you feel in an anger with men and you feel in a rage with men.
I was worried I was being unethical still being with him. Like,
well, I agree, but you've been unethical for 26 years being with him.
Yeah.
And now's not the time to start getting all of a sudden all high and mighty about it, but understanding, yeah. Firstly, let's go back to what I would do in the situation. I'd go, okay, how do I feel about men generally? My feelings about men are, you can list some for me, Elvira. Just be honest about how you feel.
They're controlling. And
they're controlling, okay. Yeah. And you're not controlling, are you?
Oh, I'm controlling.
Okay. No, that's good. keep going.
Oh, I think they scare me.
You're afraid of... Do you know why you're afraid? So let's just say they scare me, but so there's fear, but the question has to be asked, why? Why do they frighten you so much?
I'm not sure at this moment. Hold on.
You told me the reason yesterday.
When do you mean? Like,
what happened when you were little?
You said I needed to experiment of whether that was true or not. I haven't done that yet.
No, but you feel that it possibly is?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you feel there's been some form of abuse from a male towards yourself? Yes. Mm. So of course you're going to fear a group of people who perpetrated abuse towards you. Can you see that? So that's a primary reason for your fear. It's interesting when I ask you, why are you afraid? You go, I don't really know. And yet you've actually already stated the primary reason why you're afraid, right? What other reasons are you afraid? So you're afraid of men because they can potentially abuse you. Yeah. So let's write that down. They're stronger than you and therefore can overpower you and hurt you. Isn't that a primary reason? What's another? Any other reasons?
They're the main ones. I generally like men beyond those things.
Why do you like men? Tell me why you like men. So you had a love-hate relationship with them?
Yeah.
let's look at why you like men.
They're more direct than women.
So you like their honesty?
Yeah.
And directness, right?
They tend to be interested in more things that I'm interested in than most women.
Okay, so they have a wider scope of interest that matches yours.
Yeah.
These are, of course, not my opinions. They're yours that I'm writing down because I don't agree with all of them, but I'm happy to write them down because they're yours.
Well, the ones I've come across anyway.
Yeah, no, that's fine, because yeah. They're going to be the ones you attract, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. What else do you feel about them? Now, can I just show you that if these were the only emotions you had towards men, you would never be angry with them, would you? No. So these emotions are not creating your anger, are they? Can you see that?
No.
These emotions are like, oh, I think they're honest and direct, that's really good. I like their scope of interest, it's really good. These are things I like about these fellas, you know, like, so they're nice to me. Like, and you'd never be upset and angry and worried about what you like. The only areas that are going to cause you to get angry and fear-based are the fear-based areas, aren't they? Can you see that? So can you see if I'm in your situation, I'd be primarily looking at this particular emotion. That'd be my highest priority if I'm focusing on sorting out my relationship. Yeah?
Well, I've experimented with that one a lot. And...
Well, I don't know if I could agree with you there, Vera.
Oh, God, it feels like I...
You have not felt the emotions associated with it. You have intellectually come across these things in the past, but you've not yet fully felt the emotions. Because if you fully feel the emotion, the fear would disappear and therefore the anger with men would disappear. Do you understand? So you are afraid of this still, which tells me that the emotions are not addressed. So while you may have... What I find happens with a lot of issues with regard to any form of use, whether it's physical, emotional or sexual in nature, any form of use has this general response. Here's the situation of the abuse and what it's caused. Let's call that the war. Here's the person who has been abused. Often it's a woman. She intellectually makes steps and emotionally makes some steps until she gets to the wall. Then once you hit the wall, as the saying goes, everything hits the fan. right? That's when the real emotions start being triggered, the emotions about sex and love and open heart. And it's really, in the end, this wall is what creates the lack of open heart. You're going to have to open your heart to get through this wall. And that's what you're absolutely terrified of doing. Yes? So this is the issue that we face, right?
I don't even know what that means, like.
I know, but you've got to be careful here that you don't, because you're so afraid, that you don't say, I don't even know what that means, so I'm going to give up before I begin. You can discover what that means through a process, but you need to engage the process. You've got to be careful that we do not use as an excuse our fear. You see, this wall is a wall of fear, yeah? It's a wall of fear that every time in the past we come up to, we bounce off of. Right? And I've seen this happen over and over and over and over again. You imagine in 2,000 years of life helping people to confront their fears, you're going to see this happen very, very frequently. Right?
I've gone into this so many times. What am I missing? Like, I've been shaking and feeling shame, and what am I not doing? I'm obviously not doing something.
You don't want to open your heart.
To men.
Yeah.
You don't want to open your heart. Because I'm afraid of them.
Well, you don't want to open your heart. You don't want to trust one of them. Right?
Because I think I did trust this man. And
exactly. That's the reason why. That's what you have to go through, the feeling of all of this. Like, once you release the feeling that you trusted somebody and they hurt you, doesn't matter whether it's physically, emotionally or sexually or any other way, that you trusted them and they hurt you, right? Once you go through that emotionally, you'll actually release that from you, and now you'll be able to go, oh yeah, I can't trust that man. Sorry about that. Sorry. But I can trust that man. You'll be able to feel that you can, and you will, right? You'll feel the man you can't trust because you can feel in him the emotions that this other man had in your life. And so you won't be able to, you'll be able to know, like, I can trust my own assessment of this situation. At the moment, you can't trust your assessment in situation of any man, because at the moment, this underlying emotion guides all of your interactions with every man, including, of course, whoever is your partner. So fear is stopping you from opening your heart. Now, on the other hand, you want your man to open his heart to you, don't you?
Well, he's in the same position as me, yeah. He doesn't trust women either.
Of course. That's the kind of man that we want. Yeah. So that way we're both happy of living a life where basically we're happy living this life. There's you, there's him, here's the wall. And that's our relationship. We get some of our addictions met through this wall, but none of us have to open our heart. None of us have to actually confront any major issues. None of us have to be emotionally expressive, and none of us have to love with all of our being.
I mean, I've been happy with it the way it is there, where he's not opening up and I'm not opening up and we're pretending to have a marriage. But now I don't want that anymore.
Of course. So you can't then go, I'm leaving you because you don't want what I want, when you wanted him like that before, and he's now got to also go through this process of getting used to the fact that you want something different.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Because you're saying you want that wall down. But to get that wall down, this wall, which is only inside of you, has to come down. Do you understand? Now, if you had released this wall and then said to him, I don't know if we can stay in a relationship, I would understand more. But if you have not released this wall and you say to him, I don't want to stay in a relationship with you, I'd have to question what your motivation is, because you're still not releasing the thing that causes the blockage on your side. Yeah. Do you understand? Now, I understand that he has the same wall. I understand that he might have a wall. I don't know if it's as large as yours, so I'll draw it a bit smaller, because I feel it's not as large as yours. There's a wall. There's his wall. All right. There's him. But he has got some other walls, not just a relationship. He's got some other walls to emotion. Yes?
Yes.
So he has another wall there. So this wall is the relationship wall. That's yours, right? The opening your heart wall. But then to open his heart, he's going to have to be able to feel some grief. You're able to feel some grief, right? At the moment, you're feeling some, right? So you're able to feel some, so you don't have that additional wall to work your way through. He does, right? So would it be right for me then to go, I come up to the wall and I bounce off of it. Would it be right for me, ethically right for me, to then expect him to come up to his walls and go through them? When I go up to my wall and I bounce off it. Can you see? It would not be ethically right, would it, for me to expect that I can go up to my wall and bounce off at any time I want, but he has to go up to his walls and work through them. Right? What would be more ethical, first for a start for me, would be for me to go up to my wall and actually deconstruct it, brick by brick if I need to, right? And then once I've deconstructed it, I now can say to him, I've been willing to give you my heart now, but this is the wall you've got. Now I can actually have some ethical desire for him to do the same. Does that make sense?
So the way I face my fear is by opening my heart.
Yes, yes. You're afraid of going into a relationship. The way you address the fear is by opening your heart. Yes, you're going to need to open your heart through a process. It's not going to be something you're going to be able to do overnight. It's like, if you're open your heart, like, it's not going to be open sesame, you know, like, and it happens like that. It's going to be a process that you're going to need to engage. And it's going to be confronting because it's been there for a long time.
Well, the way I've been doing it is just by becoming more honest about how I feel.
Yeah,
but... Is that enough?
No, it's not enough. There's got to be a willingness to feel your terror, which is what I discussed with you yesterday. Because the wall is a wall of terror. Right? So we can be honest. Honesty is essential because honesty says this wall exists. That's honesty. So honesty is saying, yes, I have this wall. That's a very good step because without being honest, you're never going to even do anything about the wall. But the next step is to destroy the wall. And to destroy the wall is a wall of fear. To destroy anything emotionally, we need to feel it, to release it. So we're going to need to feel the terror.
Have I done pieces of it?
Of course you've done pieces of it. You know
so
you
I
have.
So I just need to
You would not have pieces. Even been able to get into grief when I was just talking to you just earlier about the subject. Instead, you would have got into rage, which remember in previous discussions you have gotten into. So the fact is now I can speak with you about a subject that before caused rage, and now it doesn't cause rage, is an indication you have dealt with some things about the wall. So this is very good. That's progress, isn't it? That's forward progress. Yes. However, what you really want in your life is for the wall to be gone, isn't it?
Yeah.
That would be beautiful, wouldn't it? To imagine living a life without any fear of relationship, without any fear of your heart being hurt. You know, this would be fantastic. It'd be a beautiful thing to experience. So then the wall doesn't exist. I don't have to feel it anymore because it's not there anymore. Now I've opened my heart. And now this other person who may or may not be my soulmate is faced with some decisions ethically inside of themselves. And we can point that out to them. Right? So that's what I've had to do. And Mary is going through this. Exactly this. So that Mary's heart's still blocked towards me. Mary's heart still, she's got grief to feel that she hasn't felt yet. She's got the wall of fear that she's got about relationship, which she's going through. That's why she's walked in and out of our discussion today, because she can feel those feelings in her and she's gone away to feel them. Does that make sense? And I've opened my heart and she knows I have. Right? And that becomes more attractive, doesn't it, to somebody when you do that. Now, I'm not going to say to Mary, I've opened my heart, now you have to open yours. But I can say to Mary, I've opened my heart, if you don't open yours, then we still don't have a relationship. Right? I can say that, because we don't. We don't until both of us have an open heart.
Yeah? Thank you.
So that's what I would advise. Yeah. Well, it's time to have a break, eh? Should we do that? If we come back at one, there's some food there that everyone's got together, and let's do that, and we'll come back at 1 o'clock. Pleasure.